Howdy. Boy, that thing is loud today, isn't it? Welcome to worship, everyone. Good to see everybody. And as always, hope that it's good to be seen. We have a beautiful day going out there after some good rain. I don't know, has anybody heard, did we set a record yet?
Yes.
Okay, I kind of figured that because we got a half an inch the day before and a quarter inch yesterday, so yeah.
Anything prayer doesn't work.
Yeah, that's right. Prayer does work. Prayer does work. The Lord has been merciful to us in keeping our state green. Okay, we're going to have some prayers now, and you do have the list that is provided in your bulletin, so you can have that out as we are praying, just so that you're looking at people's names. And just a reminder that during the week, you can tear that out, place it someplace where you're going to see it. And if the Lord kind of gets you to focus on a particular name, you don't have to know exactly what's going on. Just simply lift them up to the Lord and saying, Lord, I don't know what's going on, but you do. And in fact, you could do that and open up the scriptures and pray the scripture on behalf of that person. That's kind of a cool deal. All right, so do we have additional prayers? Okay, back here with Debbie.
I would like prayers for Carol Beck. She's not here today because she's isolating before surgery. She will have surgery on Tuesday morning, and it's a partial knee replacement.
Thank you, Debbie. Can we turn this down just a shade? Okay, we have one back there, Todd.
I'd like to ask for prayers for our good friends, Jim and Beth Tardew from Grants Pass. Jim was life-flighted to a hospital in Seattle on Friday. He's suffering from cancer and kidney failure. And his wife, Beth, asked Michelle to go up there with her and comfort her.
Thank you, Todd.
My Aunt Jackie, she's ill, and it's from Easter, and that's it.
Okay. Thank you, Frankie. She had gotten COVID. She's on the other side of it now. She's doing a lot better, and so thank you for that reminder. Thanks, Frankie. Any others? One back there, Meredith. In the booth. In the booth. We can't. People that need to hear can't. I didn't come out right.
So you've been following, if you've been on Facebook, you've been following my posts from my cousin in Australia. Ashley, who was unresponsive, was moved to the stroke ward, so she's out of ICU. And then Friday night, I got this message. Hi, cuz. She is talking. When Eleanor walked into the hospital, Ashley looked at her and said, hi, Mom. And so she quickly called Toby, her husband, and passed her over to him. And she said, hi, Toby. And she's doing really, really good. And she wants to thank everybody that's been praying for her because, as we all know, God still does miracles.
Absolutely. Awesome. That's wonderful news. Any others? Okay, well, the Lord knows those folks that we name before him in our hearts. So let's go before our Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father and gracious God, we give you thanks, first of all, for your presence with us. It gives us a great amount of confidence and joy to know that you draw near to us. And not just in the times of need, also in times of great joy and celebration, when we give you praise and thanksgiving for all that you do. And so as we lift these folks before you, we also have in mind those that we have been keeping in our hearts throughout weeks, days, months, and years. And we know that you are active in their lives. So please, Lord, continue to take care of these folks and spur us on to prayer on their behalf. Help us to focus on one that you have in mind just for us, for each one of us to pray for, and that you will do the work. And so we lift before you John Roberts, who has sepsis from some failed operations, and now thinking that there is a hole in his esophagus, which has turned sepsis. And so, Lord, hold him close and give him peace and healing. For Jim and Beth, seeking your peace, your presence to be with them, as Jim is under dialysis now, needing a lot of help. So, Lord, we know that you are one of great compassion, and so we ask that you will lay your hand upon him in your compassion and in your healing capacity. Let there be wholeness again. We lift before you Carol Beck, and we pray that you will help the surgeon and the assisting people, that the surgery will go well, and that partial knee replacement will be one in which she will be up and walking around and doing so much better without all the pain that she's been experiencing. It's an amazing thing, Lord, how you give wisdom and skills for the technology that is developing to help people live more quality lives, where there are replacement of joints and even of various internal organs. It's an amazing thing, Lord. We thank you. We also lift before you Jackie, thanking you that she's getting better, regaining her strength. So lift her up, please, Lord, and give her your grace that she will know you are there for her and you will give her refreshment of life. And praising you, Lord, for Ashley's continued recovery, thanking you that she is now talking, doing as well as she is. It's in itself a miracle that you are providing for this family and for all those who are around, testimony to your activity in people's lives. So for these folks and for others, we lift them before you, seeking your grace, your healing to be upon them, and we will praise you. We will give you thanks for your wonderful love, the promise of restoration, and we pray you to you in Jesus' name, amen. Please stand as you're able for our first hymn. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning.
rise every morning. God's recreation of the new day.
Together we pray. O God, by the humiliation of your Son, you lifted up this fallen world, rescuing us from the hopelessness of death. Grant your faithful people a share in the joys that are eternal, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Lord, we're asking for salvation and for peace around the world. For the leaven come from heaven and the unity of all. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on us all. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on us all. For the churches of our country, those who worship everywhere, offering praises, Lord, please save us. Mercy, Lord, and hear our prayer. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on us all. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on us all.
You who are loved by the Lord, let us draw near to him with a true heart and admit our sins unto God, our Father, sincerely asking him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. In the Bible, 1 John chapter 1, it says, if we say that we have done nothing to offend God, we're only fooling ourselves, not telling the truth. But if we admit our sins, God, who is faithful, right, and good, will forgive us our shortcomings and make us clean from all our wickedness. I will confess my sins unto the Lord, and I will trust that God will forgive my wickedness and unfair judging of others. Let us confess our sins together. Gracious God, I know that I am naturally sinful and unclean, and I know that I have offended you in thought, word, and deed by what I have done and by what I have left undone. I have not loved you with my whole heart, and I have not loved my neighbor as myself. Therefore, I come to you for shelter in your limitless mercy, seeking and asking for your grace, that you will forgive me, renew me, and lead me as a result of the life, death, and rising from the dead of your Son, Jesus the Christ. Hear the good news, for Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, has had mercy upon us, and he has given his only Son, Jesus, to die for us. And through Jesus, God forgives us all our sins. To everyone who believes in Jesus, he gives the right to become a child of God and gives to them the gift of his Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Please be seated.
Well,
as Bob Barker used to say, come on down. No, he didn't say it. Who was it that said that? Johnny something. Did he say come down? Doesn't matter, I guess. Does it? No, it doesn't. You're right. You're right on. Right on. Right on. Right on. Oh, my goodness. Hi there. Welcome. It's so good to see you. I sure like the way you're dressed. That's pretty snazzy. And it said you have a unicorn that says one of a kind. And you are one of a kind. Yep, that is for sure. You're God's child. You're a gift to all of us. You know that, don't you? Something about a cat? Okay. Well, I'm all into cats. So, you want to come over here and open the little one? Take that out of there and let's see what's in it. Come on. Come on over here. Take that out. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Now I want you to open it. So let's see. It's on the other side over here. Yeah. There you go. Open that little thing right there. See it? Okay. Let's see. Oh, we'll push it this way. There you go. Now let's open it. Ooh. I wonder what we have here. We have a box. It's a pretty nice box, don't you think? I wonder what's in it. Okay. And another box. Okay, so this one doesn't say anything. This one says strong, love, blessed, proud, happy, peace. All right, now we'll open it. Oh, and then inside of it is a ring with a note. Professional something. I can't even read it.
Million mile truck driver.
Oh, okay. Professional million mile truck driver. That must be you. How about that, huh?
Wow.
It says, if you have it, a truck brought it. God gives it all. Amen with that. All right. Now, today we're going to hear a story about Jesus coming along on the lakeside. Okay, he's at the shore. And his disciples, the guys that follow him, they're out and they've been fishing. Okay? And this happened right after Jesus was raised from the dead. In other words, he is risen. And when they're out there fishing, they haven't caught anything. Jesus asked them the question as they're coming in on that morning, and he says, "Hey, you got any fish?" And they said, "No." So he said, "Hey, toss your net off the right side of the boat, you find some." And they did, and they had so many fish, didn't know what to do with them. Couldn't haul them in. But then they realized it was Jesus, and they were pretty excited. Now, what does a ring like this have to do with that? Well, let me suggest some things. This is a very special reward that comes from a million miles of driving truck and no accidents, right? No accidents. So that's pretty awesome. We have a celebrity here, folks. Now she's saying she thinks you had one.
It wasn't his fault.
Okay, so that, hey, you're off the hook then, right? That's cool. I like it. Was that a deer?
No, that was three.
Oh, it was three deer. Well, you got two more on me then. Okay. So it's a treasure. It really is a treasure to have this because it means that you've earned something. It means that there has been a reward. All right? Now, when Jesus is talking to his disciples, these fishermen, he's not going to give them a reward, but he's going to give them a wonderful gift. And that is, he's going to remind them that they belong to him. Because when they come up to the shore, they see that Jesus has made breakfast for them. And they're tired. They've fished all night and they didn't catch anything, but now they've caught so much and they know it's Jesus, and Jesus says, "Come on and have breakfast and bring some of the fish they just caught." And so they did that. And I can only imagine what did they ask Jesus? You know, they'd seen him a couple other times, but what were they talking about at that time? And then by Jesus being there, And I'm going to be telling the adults about this a little bit. I'm not going to let Kat all the way out of the bag here. But with these disciples, the particular ones that were in the boat, they're ones that had done something particular with Jesus. And so he's telling them, you know, I'm not angry with you. I am still loving you, and I'm going to give you a kind of like a reward, and that is the assurances that you belong to me, and I'm not going to let you go. Okay? So when you see something like this, it's a real awesome thing. It's something that you've earned, but Jesus gave his disciples something they didn't. They thought that maybe they'd lost Jesus' love. But Jesus is wanting them to know, no, you haven't. You haven't. And I'm going to make things better for you. I'm going to forgive you. In fact, I already have. That's pretty cool, don't you think? Have Jesus forgiving our sins? Yeah. We don't deserve it. Nope. But he says, I want you to have it because that's how much I love you. Cool. All right. Thank you for sharing that with us, Robert. That's pretty cool. Yeah. Okay, we're going to have a prayer. So what, Jace, what's one thing we do when we pray?
Fold our hands.
Okay, we fold our hands. So we fold our hands. Can we do that? Fold our hands. And then what's another thing we do?
Bow our heads.
We bow our heads. And so we go like this. And then what's the other thing we do, Jace?
Close our eyes.
And we close our eyes. And we do that. Why?
Show God respect.
We show God respect. So we'll have a prayer. Thank you, God. Thank you for giving us your love. And through your son, Jesus, you continue to love us and you forgive our sins. And we are grateful to you. We find joy in knowing that you continue to love us always. So lead us, Lord, into your love and teach us how to love others. And I ask this in Jesus' name. And all God's children say, amen. And we do a yee-haw. Thanks for coming up. Now, I have something I'd like for you to do for me. I'm going to close this up, and then you get to... There we go. It's almost pastor-proof. I want you to take that, and you'll get some help to find somebody to give it to. And oh boy, oh boy, oh boy. That is a very cool ring.
Thank you.
Hasn't found anybody yet, right? Well, that's right. We have Children's Church back there. There's Ms. AJ. Yeah, cool.
Good morning. Goodness. Our psalm is Psalm 30. That's found on page 544, and I'd like to do it responsively. I will extol you, O Lord, for you have drawn me up and have not let my foes rejoice over me.
O Lord, my God, I cried to you for help, and you have healed me.
O Lord, you have brought up... Yeah, can't even read. O Lord, you have brought up my soul from Sheol. You restored me to life from among those who go down to the pit.
Sing praises to the Lord, O you, his saints, and give thanks to his holy name.
For his anger is but for a moment, and his favor is for a lifetime. Weeping may tarry for the night, but joy comes with the morning.
With me, I said in my prosperity, I shall never be moved.
By your favor, O Lord, you made my mountain stand strong. You hid your face. I was dismayed.
To you, O Lord, I cry, and to the Lord I plead for mercy.
What profit is there in my death if I go down to the pit? Will the dust praise you? Will it tell you of your faithfulness?
Hear, O Lord, and be merciful to me. O Lord, be my helper.
You have turned for me my mourning into dancing. You have loosened my sackcloth and clothed me with gladness.
That my glory may sing your praise and not be silent. O Lord, my God, I will give thanks to you forever.
The first reading is from Acts chapter 9. That's found on page 1090, verses 1 through 22. But Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any belonging to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now as he went on his way, he approached Damascus, and suddenly a light from heaven shone around him. And falling to the ground, he heard a voice saying to him, Saul, Saul, why are you prosecuting me? And he said, Who are you, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But rise and enter the city. You will be told what you are to do. The men who were traveling with him stood speechless, hearing the voice, but seeing no one. Saul rose from the ground, and although his eyes were opened, he saw nothing. So they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. And for 3 days he was without sight and neither ate nor drank. Now there was a disciple at Damascus called Ananias. The Lord said to him in a vision, Ananias, and he said, Here I am, Lord. And the Lord said to him, Rise and go to the street called Straight at the house of Judas. Look for a man of Tarsus named Saul, for behold, he is praying, and he has seen in a vision a man named Ananias come in and lay his hand on him so that he might regain his sight. But Ananias answered, Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much evil he has done to your saints at Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priests to bind all who call on your name. But the Lord said to him, Go, for he is a chosen instrument of mine to carry my name before the Gentiles and the kings and the children of Israel. For I will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name. So Ananias departed and entered the house, and laying his hands on him, he said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus has appeared to you on the road by which you have come, has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with Holy Spirit. And immediately something like scales fell from his eyes and he regained his sight. Then he rose and was baptized, and taking food, he was strengthened. For some days he was with the disciples in Damascus, and immediately he proclaimed Jesus in the synagogue, saying, He is the Son of God. And all who heard him were amazed and said, Is this not the man who made havoc in Jerusalem of those who called upon his name? Has he not come here for this purpose, to bring them bound before the chief priests? But Saul increased all the more in strength and confounded the Jews who lived in Damascus by proving that Jesus was the Christ. The second reading is Revelation 5, verses 1 through 14, and that is on page 1221. I can't even read today. And then I saw in the right hand of him who was seated on the throne a scroll written within and on the back, sealed with seven seals. I saw a mighty angel proclaiming with a loud voice, Who is worthy to open the scrolls, to open the scroll and break its seals? And no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth is able to open the scroll or to look into it. And I began to weep loudly, because no one was found worthy to open the scroll or to look into it. One of the elders said to me, Weep no more. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has conquered, so that he can open the scroll and its seven seals. And between the throne and the four living creatures among the elders, I saw a lamb standing, as though he had been slain, with seven horns and with seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God, sent out unto all the earth. And he went and took the scroll from the right hand of him who was seated at the throne. And when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each holding a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, Worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God, from every tribe and language and people and nation. And you have made them a kingdom and priests for our God, and they shall reign on earth. Then I looked and heard the throne and the living creatures and the elders, the voice of many angels, numbering myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands, saying in a loud voice, Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing. And I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth in the sea and all that is in them saying, To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever. And the four living creatures said, Amen, and the elders fell down and worshipped. Here ends the readings. Please rise for the gospel. Stay.
Thank you. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 21st chapter. After this, Jesus revealed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he revealed himself in this way. Simon Peter, Thomas called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples were together. Simon Peter said to them, I am going fishing. They said to him, We will go with you. They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just as day was breaking, Jesus stood on the shore, yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, Children, do you have any fish? They answered him, No. He said to them, Cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some. So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because of the quantity of the fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved therefore said to Peter, It is the Lord. When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garment, for he was stripped for work, and threw himself into the sea. The other disciples came in the boat dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, but about 100 yards off. When they got on land, they saw a charcoal fire in place with fish laid out on it and bread. Jesus said to them, Bring some of the fish that you have just caught. So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore, full of large fish, 153 of them. And although there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, Come and have breakfast. Now none of the disciples dared ask him, Who are you? They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and so with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus was revealed to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? He said to him, Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He said to him, Feed my lambs. He said to him a second time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He said to him, Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He said to him, Tend my sheep. He said to him the third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, Do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, Feed my sheep. Truly, truly, I say to you, when you were young, you used to dress yourself and walk wherever you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands, and another will dress you and carry you where you do not want to go. This he said to show by what kind of death he was to glorify God. After saying this, he said, follow me. Peter turned and saw the disciple whom Jesus loved following them, the one who had been reclining at the table close to him and had said, Lord, who is it that is going to betray you? When Peter saw him, he said to Jesus, Lord, what about this man? Jesus said to him, if it is my will that he remain until I come, what is that to you? You follow me. So the saying spread abroad, the brothers, that this disciple was not to die, yet Jesus did not say to him that he was not to die, but if it is my will that he remain until I come, what is that to you? This is the disciple who is bearing witness about these things, and who has written these things, and we know that his testimony is true. Now there are many other things that Jesus did. Were every one of them to be written, I suppose that the world itself could not contain the books that would be written. This is the gospel of our Lord. Please be seated.
Of the living God, pull afresh on me, Spirit of the living God, pull afresh on me. Melt me, mold me, fill me, use me, Spirit of the living God, pull afresh on me.
Dear friends and family in Christ, may God's grace, his mercy, and his peace be to you from the one who is, who was, and who is to come, our Savior Jesus, who is Christ. Amen. Their heads were still spinning. Twice Jesus appeared to his disciples following his resurrection, demonstrating that he was bodily present, he was truly present. Twice Jesus pronounced peace upon them, the peace that only he could give. Twice he showed them his hands and his side. Twice they were glad when they saw Jesus, their Lord. Once in this room, Jesus tells the disciples he is sending them just as the Father had sent him. We are told that Jesus did many more signs in the presence of his disciples to assure them that he was indeed alive. He is risen. So what's the deal? After this, we are told, seven of them were together and Peter says, I'm going to go fishing. Going fishing. One would think that these fellows would be ramped up and shouting good news from the street corners, from the rooftops, in the marketplace, and especially the temple. What is going on? Well, you see, there was a problem. They were on a hit list. If they were recognized, some snitch would lead the authorities right to their door. What do you do when you're afraid, confused, sad, or even depressed, or just trying to make decisions about what needs to be done in life? Whether it's about family difficulties or work-related issues or a need to have space to think without distraction. For me, it's working in the soil with my hands, tinkering with machinery, rearranging the furniture in my study, or doing something just to get my brain distracted from the problem at hand. Been there? That's why sometimes you go into my study and you see things are in a different place. You know that I've been trying to distract my brain from something, just letting it work some things out. For Peter and six other disciples, it was to go fishing. That's what they knew. A place where they had to concentrate on the job at hand, keeping the lamp burning and the nets busy, a familiar rhythm bringing back muscle memory and friendly banter among men. They labored all night, and as luck would have it, they didn't have any luck. No luck, that is, until Jesus showed up. Did you notice the characters manning the boat? Check it out. Peter, the rock who became sand when he denied knowing Jesus. Thomas, remember him from last week, called the twin? He's known as the doubter. Nathaniel, who said, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" He was talking about Jesus. James and John, the two hotheads, sons of Zebedee. And there were two others who weren't named, but because of what we hear later on, probably was John, the disciple and writer of the gospel, and the two letters, three letters. He was the one disciple that Jesus loved. And perhaps Andrew, Peter's brother. Not recognizable in the early morning light and being around, you know, about 100 yards from shore, Jesus calls out, and this is basically how the Greek says it. "Hey guys, you catch anything?" How about that? I can almost hear Peter say, "Oh, good grief, it's the game warden." Nope, they all said together, "Not a thing. We have been truly, rurally skunked." "Well, then cast your net on the right side of the boat. You'll find some." Don't you just love it when somebody else has a different perspective and they can come out and they can say, "Oh, if you do this, you'll get this." Yeah, okay. Is that how they decide? Okay. Well, Jesus showed up. Jesus showed up. Now they had too many to handle. Now they knew. John declared, "It's the Lord." And Simon Peter jumps into the water. Can you just see this happening? "Well, it's the Lord." And here he is. He's swimming ashore, trying to get there before everybody else. And he does. But we're not told that he does or says anything. Probably just standing there looking at Jesus. While the other disciples had to struggle with the net and get the boat to the shore. I can only imagine what may have transpired between Jesus and Peter at that particular moment. Did he kneel before Jesus? Did he say something? We're never going to know because John was still in the boat. What we do know is that when they all were on shore, they saw a fire and fish on the barbie and bread to go with it. And Jesus was prepared for them having this meal ready. Provision in abundance. A miraculous catch of big fish and a breakfast. Hot doggies. Did you notice another kind of miracle that was taking place? The disciples couldn't haul the net into the boat, but Peter was able to pull the net ashore by himself when Jesus asked to bring some fish that they had just caught. An abundance of strength. "Come and have breakfast," Jesus calls. He gives an invitation to a restored fellowship and a relationship. These were broken men. Yes, they had seen Jesus twice before, but they were still broken. They were still trying to sort things out. They decided to go fishing so they might be able to think or just to clear the air. And here Jesus shows up again, telling them that he's there for them. Jesus reveals himself once more as the servant, the provider, and the giver. He's the host supreme. He passed out the food to remind them of the Last Supper they had shared with each other 12 days earlier. I wish John had recorded the conversation around that fire in the morning. What did they talk about? Reminiscing about the last 3 years, perhaps? Did Jesus explain in more detail why everything had happened the way it did? Did they sing a hymn together as they had before they went to the Garden of Gethsemane? We'll never know. We're not going to know this side of heaven, but I'm sure it was a time of joy of seeing and hearing Jesus again. And finally, Jesus restores a broken Simon Peter. Peter and all of his bravado and machismo had melted when His moment for testimony presented itself. His swearing had accomplished nothing, and he was grieved to the heart. And we are told that he wept bitterly, for he had denied and disappointed his Lord. I think we all know that look that we can get from someone who is very disappointed in us. We are told in the gospel that when Peter had denied Jesus three times, Jesus looked at Peter, and Peter was crushed. He knew he'd really messed up royally. You ever had that happen to you? You said you wouldn't do this, you did, and you got the look. That's how it was for Peter. But the way Jesus restored Peter is very tender. He didn't chew Peter out for being weak. Neither did he bash him in with I told you so. Rather, in a gentle, caring, and forgiving way, and yet in a pointed manner, he gave Peter the opportunity to pledge his love for him again. That's what Jesus does for you and for me each and every day. An opportunity to again pledge our love for him. He assured Peter that he truly would be a rock-solid person from then on, and he would grow the church. He would feed the sheep and the lambs of Jesus by going to all nations, preaching, baptizing, and absolving those who came to faith in Jesus, just as the other disciples would too. So you see, the story is one that can give us encouragement. You see, Jesus knows. He knows how we are saddened when we let him down. And how many times have we caught ourselves doing something that we knew was improper, just not right? And we have an inner grief that says, man, I really blew that one. Now what am I going to do? Well, he knows about it. He knows our grief when we fail to be the kind of Christian that he wants us to be. One who is strong, courageous, faithful. And how many of us want to be strong, courageous, and faithful to Jesus? And we mess up. Jesus wants you and me to know that his heart goes out to us. He's not ready to whip us, hit us with a celestial hammer of some sort. When we repent of our failings, our uncontrolled anger, faithlessness, and weakness, Jesus restores us. He restores us. I don't know if you heard that, but he restores us. Just as he did Peter, just as he did Thomas, just as he did the hotheads and all the rest. All had failed Jesus in one way or another. It's the same thing that we do day after day. So now is a time of questioning. It's a time in which we can hear Jesus asking each and every one of us, do you love me more than these? Do you? Do you love me more than these? Do you love me more than your parents, your siblings, your relatives, friends, people in your congregation? Do you love me more than these? Do you love me more than your job, your home, your finances? Do you? Do you love me more than these? Do you love just him? You see, that's a question that we really, 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 really need to be asking ourselves. Do I love Jesus more than these? Because it has everything to do with whose we are, who we are, what we are, what are we becoming, and what we are going to continue to be. Christians, yes. Faithful Christians, absolutely. But ones who are connected and absolutely in love with Jesus so that nothing else matters. He's not going to beat you to the ground. You see, he has forgiven your sins for Jesus' sake. He has set up a meal for you here. Yeah, it's not on the fire, but it's one that will give you such sustenance. It's an incredible thing. It's a miracle in itself. He calls you to be his children. He calls you to be his friends. So refuse. Refuse to go back to the way things were and embrace the renewed life of those who are forgiven and restored. Live a life of joy. I see too many Christians walking around with their faces hanging on the ground, afraid of what is happening around and what is going to happen to them. You've heard it before. Martin Luther was asked one day, what would you do if you knew the world was going to end tomorrow? And I think if we were asked, we'd probably try to think of something that we would do that we've never done before. Oh, I'd go to Europe for a day. Really? Or I'd do this for a day. Luther says, I'd go plant a tree. That's how confident he was in his love for Jesus. He would continue doing what he was doing as a steward of God's good earth, as a steward of the commission that we are given to tell others about Jesus. If we were told you have one day before the world ends, would you be thinking about telling someone else about Jesus or making your final preparations? Do you love me more than these, Jesus says. Refuse to go back the way things were. Don't go back to just fishing. Rather, take up your cross, follow Jesus, and fish for people. Don't go around thinking of ways you might serve God. Rather, go to the hungry sheep and lambs of God and take care of them. Do what you say you are going to do. That's how you serve God. It's too easy to say, well, I'm going to serve God. Okay? How is that? How is it going to happen? What do you have in mind? How are you going to put your creativity, the knowledge, the wisdom that you have, how will you put it to work? How are you going to make it serve God? That is what Jesus is looking for as he says, do you love me more than these? How are you going to put that, give it feet, and put it on the ground and get it busy? Well, you see, when Jesus shows up, when he comes to restore, because we are forgiven for his sake, he does some pretty heavy-duty business with us. He shows us what we need to do. Love him above all things, and then tell others about how you love Jesus above all things. When Jesus shows up, he makes things different. He gets us off the dime. He confronts us and he says, even though you have failed me in so many different ways, you are still my child. I still love you. I am still taking care of you. And I will be here beside you and within you as you serve, doing what you say you're going to do. So now you need to figure out, what am I going to do? What am I going to do for Jesus' sake? And if you can't figure out something, why don't you get together with another person and say, isn't this something we can do that will serve God, serve our fellow human beings, make their life more worthwhile, more exciting, more joyful, more in a saving manner? Because you love Jesus more than these. You see, that's what happens when Jesus shows up. He really does turn everything on its ear. He takes everything that we've known and he says, that's good, but there's something better. Let me show you. First of all, remember, I love you more than these. Amen. Please stand for the hymn of the day. Jesus calls us o'er the tumult of our lives, well blessed see. Day by day his clear voice sounding, saying, Christian, follow me. As of old Saint Andrew heard it by the Galilean lake, turn from home and toil and kindred, leaving all for his dear sake. Jesus calls us from the worship of the vain world's golden store. Still he calls in cares and pleasures, saying, Christian, love me more. In our joys and in our sorrows, days of toil and ills of ease, still he calls in cares and pleasures, Christian, love me more than these. Jesus calls us in your mercy, Savior, take us, hear your call, give up to your obedience, serve and love you best of all. We confess our Christian faith using the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let's share the peace with one another. Peace, Lord, artists. Peace, Lord, Karen. Peace. Peace, Lord, Meg. Peace, Lord, Kathy.
There.
It's a landmine up here.
we're kind of scratched over,
yeah,
all over this way. Might get some nicer weather today than yesterday.
Pardon?
Might get some nicer weather today than yesterday.
That's what the little weather app says that we're supposed to have today. Yep.
Okay.
cute little one.
We'll receive the offering now.